Hello, everyone. Let's continue our morning session today. Wojciech Kryński from IMPAN, Institute of Mathematics, Polish Academy of Sciences, is going to talk about an variational approach to conformal geodesics. Wojciech, please.
So thank you for this opportunity of giving a talk here. I'm going to talk about conformal geometry, but let us start with Riemannian case. So in the Riemannian case, there is a class of distinguished curves, well known, of course, under the name of geodesics, which are the locally length minimizing curves. And there are solutions to a system of second order ODEs, which comes from a Lagrangian, first of, that depends on first order derivatives of curve, so from first order Lagrangian. And of course, these geodesics are not well defined in the conformal geometry where you cannot measure the length of a curve. But there is also a distinguished class of curves in conformal geometry that are called conformal circles, because in the flat case, they are just circles. And sometimes they're also called conformal geodesics. And if you have a curve that goes around a circle, then to define a curve, you fix the starting point, velocity and acceleration. So you need three parameters. And in fact, this distinguished curves in the conformal geometry are solutions to a third order ODE, and that makes a variational approach problematic, as the Euler-Lagrange equations are typically of even order. And in this talk, I'd like to show how one can deal with these difficulties. And this is, it's based on the work, on a joint work with Maciej Dunajski from Cambridge. Yes, so this is the overview. So let me start with a definition. So let M be a conformal n-dimensional manifold. So we have a manifold M and conformal class G. And then I will use a definition that comes from a paper of Bailey and Eastwood. So they defined the conformal geodesics as solutions to the following third order equation. So it's written in terms, so one, if you pick a metric G in your conformal class, then you have a Levi-Civita connection for this metric. And then you can write this expression that I denote here by E. So U in this expression is the velocity of a curve, A is acceleration computed with the use of this Levi-Civita connection for metric G, and P is a Skouten tensor. But then one can check that this, so of course the a priori this equation, this expression depends on your choice of a metric in the conformal class, but one can check that in fact it's independent on the choice. So it transforms, this equation is conformally invariant. And the conformal geodesics or conformal circles are exactly the by definitions are solutions to this third order system of ODEs. Okay, and now the goal is to somehow, we'd like to mimic the Riemannian case where the geodesics are comes from a Lagrangian, when we minimize energy or length of a curve. So here our goal is to characterize conformal geodesics as critical points of a functional. So what we are looking for, a functional, and usually in the calculus of variation, this functional is an integral functional where we integrate the Lagrangian along a curve. And this this Lagrangian L depends on the, can depend on time, on the position, on the velocity, and higher derivatives of the curve. But also there's a second important ingredient in this picture, namely a class of variations. So if we want to have, we want this our curve to be a critical point, but with respect to certain class of admissible perturbations. So typically one, for instance, can fix endpoints of a curve and then consider variations that keep these endpoints invariant. But also one can fix some submanifolds and try to and put a condition that perturbation of a curve keep join these two submanifolds, or but this, the class of variations can be even more complicated. For instance, this is the case in the Subriemannian geometry when one has to deal with non-holonomic constraints, and in this Subriemannian case, it's very subtle task to pick proper variations of the curve. But anyway, so I would like to stress here that we look for two main ingredients: the functional and the class of variations. So let me briefly recall the general approach in the calculus of variations. I think everyone knows this as this biological part of the conference just left the conference. But anyway, let me briefly recall that when we want to solve some variational problem, we compute the a derivative of our functional with respect to this parameter S that parameterizes a perturbation of our curve. And then we integrate by parts as many times as we need, and we get a formula of the form of the following form, where this we have some boundary terms which are usually vanish if we consider proper variations, and here we have this vector field along a curve, and this F is in fact the vanishing of F gives the Euler Lagrange equations, which are of order 2k, where k is the order of the Lagrangian. Okay, so but how can we modify this to get equations that are not of even order? So naive idea is to stop integration by parts earlier and aim for this variation of the functional in the following form, where this BT are again the boundary terms, but then instead of a vector field along a geodesic, we have some differential operator acting on V. So, but then the number of problems appear. So first of all, we have to adjust the class of variations such that a variant of the fundamental lemma of the calculus of variation can be applied in order to get, because our reasoning is that we'd like to conclude that in order to the variation vanish for any v in the class, even only if then this f vanish. So we have to prove a kind of the fundamental lemma of the calculus of variations, where instead of just variation, we have an image of some differential operator v. So for this, to have this image of sufficiently large, we need to enlarge the class of variations, and one may expect when we enlarge the class of admissible variations, then we have a small number of critical points, which means that we have a lower order of an ODE that describe this critical points, or which are curves in this case. And additionally, in the case of the conformal geodesics, everything has to be, of course, conformally invariant. So, so this is the plan. We want to find the differential operator as well as the Lagrangian, and such that everything works. And as a result, you want to have as this f here our equation e, the third order equation. Differential operator, so we define this differential operator in the following way. One can, so this is an adjustment of the covariant the derivative. Here u, as before, is a vector, is a velocity of the curve, and then of nabla is Levi-Civita connection for our choice of metric g in the conformal class. And but then one can check that if we add this zero order term, then this is well defined conformal first order differential, conformally invariant first order differential operator. And it since this a, which is an acceleration of a curve, appears here, so this differential operator depends on the second jet of the curve. And then as for the Lagrangian, so there is a natural candidate for the Lagrangian, which was found by Bailey and Eastwood in the paper I mentioned. So this is a second, this LBE is a second order Lagrangian, which is, however, not conformally invariant. It's only conformally invariant up to a differential of a function, which is sufficient if one considers the usual variations that keep the endpoints from this Lagrangian one can get the fourth order ODEs that is fourth order system of ODEs that is conformally invariant. But for our purposes, we need to extend this to the Lagrangian that is conformally invariant, not up to this differential, but just conformally invariant. And this can be done. And this is this Lagrangian L. But now it's Lagrangian of third order. And in fact, this additional term is a differential of some expression. So this L and this Lagrangian L and the Lagrangian of Bailey and Eastwood differ only by a boundary term. So this fourth order Euler-Lagrange equations are the same for these two Lagrangians. However, if we since this L is conformally invariant, it would be more convenient in the next slides. Then this L can be also put in the following compact form, where E is the left hand side of our third order equation. So we already know that this E is conformally invariant. So this from this simple compact formula follows that L is conformally invariant Lagrangian, and this Lagrangian will also, I guess, appear in the next talk, and it also comes from some tractor viewpoint. But anyway, here this will be our main object to consider. Mm-hmm. Okay, and now our first theorem is as follows. So we can compute the variation of this integral functional, and so as a result, one can get the following expression. So here we have a boundary terms at the end. We also have our differential operator acting on a variation, on a vector field that defines a variation along a curve. Here, this E minus L is again this Lagrangian function, and this E minus 2 LU vanishes. One can check it vanishes if and only if this the equation itself vanishes. So this part that is next to this differential operator is what we are looking for, but also there's a part that that depends on the veil curvature and on the variational vector field V. So basically, it's almost in the form we wanted, but especially in the flat case, there is no this first term product K with V disappears, and so this is so in this flat case, it's in the form our equation times the differential operator acting on V plus boundary terms. This is the variation. And now we'd like to find the class of variations that is adapted to this formula. So in the flat case, as I said, this K vanishes, and we just can consider variations that satisfy for which this boundary terms vanish. In the general case, in order to have only this part we want, we need to consider the more complicated condition. But here, this right-hand side maybe on the first when the beginning maybe it looks weird, but in fact this right-hand side is just a linear functional acting on variations. So it's not that weird condition. This is just a linear condition on variations. And then having this this set, we can state the following result. So a curve is a critical point of this integral functional in the class of variations satisfying this condition, even on the if the curve is a conformal geodesic. So this gives a variational formulation for the conformal geodesics. So how we prove this? So this theorem is just not straightforward, but it's just one can check this by computation. So if we so once we have this formula, and we consider that then in this next theorem we consider variations such that this term k product k and v and boundary terms vanish. So what is left is only this term in the middle, and then we'd like to apply a version of the fundamental lemma of the calculus of variations, which means so for this we need to have in the in the image of this operator D, the bump functions. When you are proving this fundamental lemma of the calculus of variations, you consider bump functions, and then if you have a product of some expression with an arbitrary bump function, and you know that this integral is zero, then you can conclude that this expression here has to be zero. So here again, we would like to mimic this reasoning. So for this, we need to have in the image of the operator D bump functions. So this can be, since this is the first order ODE along a curve, so this it can be solved, and so for any bump function we have V such that D acting of V on V is this bump function. But then the problem is if this solution V that gives this bump function satisfies is in this class of variations that we consider. And then the next step in the proof is to so in general it isn't, but in the next step of the proof we can show that that we can modify slightly this V that gives a bump function. We can slightly modify this such that we get V in this class. So this is not completely trivial, but it can be done, and that gives this variational formulation of conformal geodesics. And so thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Any questions?
I could ask one.
It's something which enables to handle a class of curves which are not fixed at the two points, isn't it? Because you want
the endpoints are not fixed.
You want to treat this case, isn't it? Because previously it was treated by Eastwood and Bailey, isn't it, or not? The case where the points are, the endpoints are fixed.
For
another Lagrangian, which is not completely conformally invariant.
Yes, but once you fix the endpoints, then it's almost this Lagrangian is almost conformally invariant.
But, okay.
But when you fix endpoints, then it's then it is.
It becomes invariant. You want
yes, to? Yes, because it's just.
So my question is.
It just gives some boundary terms that vanish on this.
Okay. So in the theorem, what I do not understand is the nature of this condition you have in the theorem. I don't really understand the geometric nature.
In the flat case, this right hand side disappears. So you have just this bit. First, it's worth to understand the flat case. So in the flat case, the right hand side is zero.
Okay.
As k is zero, k is, depends on the veil curvature. This is just a condition on at endpoints on this, but that it depends on second jet of the, you have here this square acting on the full. So you act by this differential operator twice on the variation. So you have a kind of condition on the acceleration of the variation at endpoints.
Okay.
Which if your curves is a conformal circle, so in the flat case it's a circle. So you have this, so then this condition is just that as I wrote here, this d square acting on v is perpendicular to the velocity. So this is just some condition.
Something like this.
So you just have this. So this enlarges the class of. You don't keep your
endpoints. Yes.
Endpoints invariants.
Yeah.
So in other words, it enlarges the class of possible variations. So if you enlarge the class of variations, then it's harder to be a critical point, which means that you go from this fourth order. So if you keep endpoint invariant, you have fourth order. Equation, the usual Euler-Lagrange equations that were derived in Bailey and Eastwood, but when you enlarge this class of variations, it's harder to be a critical point, and it decreases the order of the equation by one.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah, so this is flat case. So in this. In this curved case, you have to deal with this k, which was also problematic in this paper by Eastwood and Bailey, because they had a result that in the flat case the solutions of this the conformal geodesics are solutions. To this fourth order ODE, and it's not the case in the non-flat case. But here, so it looks kind of maybe this right hand side looks artificially here, but it's. If you want to, but it's just a linear condition on your variation that comes from geometry. This vector, this k is a vector field along the geodesic, and this right hand side is a L2 norm. I mean, it's a L2 product of your variation with this.
Can I ask you just about the soft? Okay, sorry.
Yes. Yes.
Can you say how large this class operation is actually, and how can you guarantee that it's non-trivial?
How large is what?
Class of variations given by this equation.
Class of variations.
Well, this equation which you see is
how large is it? I mean,
yeah. You say something is critical on some class, right? So how large is this class?
So maybe in the flat case, it's in the flat case all variations that keep the endpoints invariant are in this class.
Yeah, in non-flat case. So can you guarantee actually, so in general, it is non-trivial, for example?
Yes, of course. Yes.
So what's the parameterization? I mean, how large?
Hi, can I step in? Maybe with an idea of
sure,
an answer? Check.
Go ahead.
Yes.
Hi, sorry. I'm in a foreign country with poor internet. I'll try. Boris, so one thing you can do is you can fix the directions at both ends, so the velocities, if you like, and a point at one end. That's a choice you can make, but you can make this choice. So two directions and one point. But as Wojtek says, the key point is that the class of variation is large enough that it contains all bump functions. And if it contains the bump functions, then you can apply the fundamental lemma and deduce the equations as stated. Thanks.
That's in the flat case, much. Because there's, well, for bump functions, the interval is non-zero.
No, I think that the point of this, but you can do it with some effort in the curved case.
But in the curved case, I don't know what you're talking about bump functions. The left-hand side is zero, the right-hand side is not.
Well, you know, a bump function is you have inside the integral, you have an inner product of what you want to vanish, your integral, your equation, with this first order of.
Yeah, I think magic is cutting. So maybe we can just take another question. Rod, you wanted to ask something?
I had a question that with any of these Lagrangians, even the one coming from Bailey and Eastwood, is there a sort of good motivation that this is a good sort of energy for the curve? Just like a normal geodesic, they're length minimizing, or there's other ways of characterizing them, but how should we think about this as a sort of energy?
So probably this will be, so the answer to this question will be given in the next talk, probably. Yes.
Oh, okay.
Because this is, I mean, this, so this Lagrangian appeared before in this tractor calculus, right? Yes. So maybe that will be explained in the next talk.
All right.
Perfect. I might not make all of that because it's getting late here, but I'll try to tell Joseph to say it at the start.
Okay. Thank you very much, Wojtek.